welcome to a brand new series of Smart. Brand new in many ways. We've got a smattering of smart new ideas for you, and we've got a brand new member of the team. Susan, welcome.
Hello, Kirsten. All right, Mark.
Mark, say hello to Susan.
At last. It's taken me all summer, 2,000 pieces, and just one to go. Never mind.
Gosh, you took that rather well, actually. Mark! Oh! Oops. Can you entertain them whilst I sort this out?
Sure. As you've just seen, jigsaws can be pretty infuriating, especially if there's a piece or two missing. But old jigsaws make great collages. Each piece has its own shapes and flecks of colour, so you can arrange them to create almost anything you like. So I'm going to start by separating my colours. Now, here's a bowl with some yellows already in. So I'm going to add some more yellows in there. I've got one with some greens, so I'll put some more greens. Right, so I've got some colours there that I need, so I'm going to start creating. Make a lovely space. Now, these greens are ideal for my stem. Brilliant. They're quite foliage-like, the texture that's already on the pieces, so that's working ideally for us. There. I'm going to hint at profile of a leaf. We'll have a shorter leaf up here. Nice one. Right, we're going to start with the top of our plants now. Now, I'm aiming for a tulip, so we need a nice, big, yellow head on this one. So we'll start with the outline. Now, these pieces have got quite a few brush strokes on them, so they look quite oil painting-like, which is really working for us. That one there. Now I'm going to go for a darker bottom part of the bulb. So we'll put some darker tones onto that. Now, painting these shades can be quite tricky normally, but as you can see, looks dead simple because it is. Just a case of placing your pieces down. That's looking really good. I'm really pleased with that. Coming along nicely. More yellow. Oh, turn that round. Just tweak that shape. And there we have it, our tulip. But the technique doesn't stop there. You can use it to create almost anything you want. Together again.
Nearly. I'm just one piece short of the full jigsaw.
You can say that again.
I'm just one piece short of the full jigsaw.
It took Leonardo da Vinci almost 10 years to paint the Mona Lisa smile.
I'm
pleased you've noticed that. Apparently he gets them made at a special shop.
No way.
Yeah.
Well, I've noticed the extra bit of elastic on them.
Yeah, that's because otherwise they'd fall off.
Really? Well, they are a bit smelly as well.
You can say that again.
They are a bit smelly as well.
Time for a tune tip. Yes, this is my top secret hideaway where I can reveal my essential cartooning tips and techniques. Let's start off with the basics, the cartoon face. Now, as you can see here, we've got two that are identical. But how can I make this one look like a boy and this one look like a girl? Very simply, give the first one some spiky hair and some freckles, and that now says cartoon boy. This one, however, if I give this one some curly hair, like that, and some little eyelids, this now says cartoon girl. But how can I age them? Well, I'll show you how to make this little chap look like an old man by simply giving him a receding hairline or no hair at all, a pair of glasses, and a set of false teeth. And this little girl now can age dramatically by again giving her some glasses, a set of false teeth, and a bit of a furrowed brow. So, there you have it. Two characters that started off identically and have changed dramatically. Why don't you have a go at building up your own library of cartoon characters? More tips next time.
A smart tip for you, lowering your colour intensity. So you've got a bright colour, like this red. The tip is, just by adding another colour, you can just take some of this sharpness out of it. Now, the colour that you need to add is burnt sienna, which is basically just a fancy name for a shade of brown. And you can see already that this sharpness has just completely gone just by blending that in straight onto the page. Now, it works with any colour, and I'll show you that just by adding some yellow onto the page. So we've got this really bright yellow here. And we'll just go for this brown again. And just blend that straight in, and straight away it's just really taking that edge off that sharpness. And there you have it. How to tone your colours down. Why don't you try it?
The work of English artist Howard Hodgkin is all about feelings, which are based on memories of places he's visited or people he's met. These feelings are then turned into vivid colours and bold shapes. His pictures often take several years to complete, and often become several paintings layered on top of each other. It's as if the picture is reflecting the way our memory of something changes over time. One of Hodgkin's major trademarks is the way he frames his pictures. The real frame is here, but he's painted over it to create a much bigger frame, designed to protect the delicate feelings and memories held within the picture. This work is called Snapshot, a memory caught in the blink of an eye, which probably explains the bold, protective frame.
Vincent van Gogh's favourite colour was yellow,
which may explain why he painted sunflowers.
Ooh, 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 ooh.
I've just crept away to this corner of the studio whilst they get ready for the next thing so that I can show you this really spooky card that you can make really easily. We've got things in the windows there. Look, all you need for starters is a sheet of coloured A4 card and then just fold it in half and then, with a quite thick pen, draw your haunted house on. I've made it look quite strange already by drawing it a very odd angle. Then you can start to add all the little extra features. So I might just put a little crack there. I've done some spooky shutters and a little crooked fence along the front as well. And on the windows, I've got the curtains on the go then. What you need to do with the windows and doors is cut them all out very carefully, like I have done there. And on the other side, just put some double-sided tape so that you can then add, I've got a nice bright yellow piece of paper so it looks like all the lights are on in the house. And then you can just go along and stick all your spooks and ghosts in the windows. So let's have this woo fella there with some really big spooky eyes just spooking out of this. And you can go along and do that in each window and really get a spooky, scary card.
Ah! It's not very spooky, is it?
Oh, I suppose nothing scares you.
No. Well, there was one strange experience that still sends shivers down my spine whenever I think about it.
Go on.
They're supposed to run the film there.
Oh. Run the film!
I'm in a city which is said to be the most haunted in Europe, and I'm visiting a castle which is over 500 years old. My mission is to capture a ghost on camera.
Yeah, right.
This is Craig Miller Castle, and it's situated on a hilltop 3 miles southeast of Edinburgh. Built in the early 1400s, it's one of the best-preserved medieval castles in Scotland. All this talk of ghosts and castles has given me a great idea. This building is perfect to sketch because it oozes mystery. So, I'm going to paint a section of it and try and create my own spooky atmosphere.
Not as though I believe in ghosts, mind you. Load of old rubbish if you ask me. Yeah.
Wow, look at this place. It's great. These trees, look. Like giant hands and fingers coming out of the ground. In fact, this place is starting to feel quite spooky already, so what I'm going to do is paint a picture using neutral colours so you won't be able to tell whether it's day or night. That means I can paint my picture now while it's still light and get out of here before it gets dark. But first, a spot of lunch. I don't know what it is about this place, but I do feel like I'm being watched. Crazy, isn't it? What? Rubbish. Why are we here? Yes, of course, yes. Drawing, that's right. Okay, that was weird. Now, this part of the building, if I just mark out just roughly positions where I want to put the windows and the doors, etc. Let's mark out the areas for the bricks. So that's great. I think it's now ready to paint. Now, I'm using blue paper so that you can't tell whether it's day or night. What I'm trying to create here is the fact the bricks are being lit from above, so there's going to be a lot of shadow underneath. That's why it's darker at the bottom of this building. So if I can just suggest that by putting the darker colours underneath the bricks like that, and then the lighter colours on top, it's quite a good effect. That's nice how the layers are all building up. Takes a while, but it's worth it. Now that's spooky. In fact, it's given me the creeps. I'm getting out of here. I wouldn't fancy being here at night. Hey! Get me out of here! Oh well, it looks like I'm not going anywhere, so I might as well finish off my picture. Right, now my painting's dry, I can work on top of it using chalks, because I think it'll give a lovely contrast. So, I'm going to start with the moon first, and just do a nice spiral of white, and smudge around the circle like that. What we need now in the foreground, I think, is a ghost. I don't think I'll give it facial features either, because what you don't see is slightly more sinister. Pick out a few areas of moonlight on the brickwork. There, that's perfect. So we've gone from a daytime picture to a spooky nighttime scene.
Hello? Anybody up there?
Nice picture, my friend.
Oh, thank you.
Here's a variation of Susan's jigsaw collage, only I'm going to use these beans and peas, these dried beans and peas, because they've got really interesting colours. Now, you can get all of these at the supermarket, and they are all dried, so you definitely can't eat those. And the first thing you need for your picture is a box lid, which has got a bit of a lip on it, like that. And then all you need to do is draw your design onto it. So I thought, because I've got all those nice yellows and browns and oranges, I'd do this ploughed field. And remember to keep your sections quite wide, because you have got to be able to get the beans in there. In the foreground, I've got this nice scarecrow here, and because I want him to look like he's in the foreground, the next thing I've got to do is just trace right round the scarecrow onto a bit of tracing paper, and then trace that onto another piece of thick card and cut it out, and then I'm just going to pop that in like that so that I don't end up filling that area just yet. But I am going to start on, I think, this section here. All you need is some PVA glue and a spreader. And just, if you do it section by section, that way you won't get into a mess with all the beans merging together. There we go. And then if you just empty the beans into containers like I've done, I think I'll start with a nice orange lentils. Then all you have to do is sprinkle them in, and you can control that quite easily. And if you do go outside the lines, all you need to do is pat it down, get it all level, get your fingers in, give it a bit of a squeeze, like that. There's one section, and you can just, when that's all dried, tap the excess off. I think I'll do this section over here next. I'll do that. There we go. Bit of glue again. Splodge it all around. Keeping clear of my scarecrow as I go. This time, let's have a look. I think I'll do these black-eyed beans. They look quite nice. These are a little bit bigger, so it takes less of these to fill the section. Squash them all down. And all you need to do is keep filling section by section, like that, until you've completed the entire thing. And it looks like this one here. You can see it really looks like a ploughed field now. And what I've done as well up here for clouds are these nice butter beans. So all we need to do now is the scarecrow in the middle. So let's just get rid of that for a second. Start on the scarecrow. I think I'll actually do a bit of his waistcoat. Let's get a splodge on there. Rub that around a bit. And I'll use the dried peas. He's going to have a nice, smart, green waistcoat, my scarecrow. There we go. Put those on like that. Lovely. Sprinkle off some of the excess like that. And the trousers, I'll just show you, because with some of the bigger beans, what you can do is rather than sprinkle them on, it's very easy to just start using them almost like mini bricks. So if I use these here, all you need to do is add them on one by one and start to build up a bit of a pattern, like you can see him doing here. That'd work right the way up his legs. And once that's all been done, hopefully, it looks something like this one here. Let's get the background back in and see what it looks like when we put it all together. Add the scarecrow in like that, and you'll see, because he's on a separate bit of card, he really does look like he's standing out and he's in the foreground of the picture. It works really well, doesn't it?
A painting by my Maltese called The Boat was hung in an art gallery for 2 months before someone noticed it was upside down.
Theme to today's show, so I understand the carpet tiles, but why have we made a giant nodding dog?
Well, what else would you make with carpet tiles? Carpet tiles? Carpet tiles.
What did I tell you?
One piece short of a full jigsaw.
Oh, yes.
Well, that's enough abstract art for one show, but we'll have plenty more for you very soon. Bye!
Bye. Come on, girls, it was quite funny.
Only the dog's agreeing with you.
You can post your gallery pictures to Smart, PO Box 5053, London W12 6AW. And if you need a fact sheet, they're available through the CBBC website.
Before we go, just got time to show you this. All you need is a bit of string with a loop in it and then thread a drawing pin through that and push it into a whole pad like that. Really press it down well. Then all you need is some chalk, and if you just colour on top of your string like that and then hold it taut and just ping it, you see when I move it away, you get a nice little mark there, and then when it runs out, just restock your string with chalk and ping around. Like that. I'm going to put some more on, I think. There we go. Just keep going right the way round. It starts to look like a sun. When you're happy you've got enough yellow, just change colour. So I'm going to put some lilac on now, like this. There we go. And it starts to build up a really pretty effect if you use a nice different colour as the background, as the paper. Like that. A few more bits of yellow, I think. And if I just blow away any excess chalk, there you have it, a beautiful starburst picture. If I get rid of the pin, you can see it in all its glory. Why don't you give it a go?